Hello YouTube, welcome back to another lesson. Today is going to be a special lesson, a different one, because we have finished already the unit 9, the Plant Kingdom, and today I'm going to sum up all the unit, and we are going to make an outline of the unit. Because I want to prepare a test at the end of the next week, so in order to prepare the exam, the test, we are going to sum the unit up. Also, at the same time, we can practice some study techniques that they are very useful. I know most of you prepare some kind of outlines or also schemes, some recap in your notebook at the end of the unit. So maybe you already know these techniques, but it's always useful to remember them and to practice them. Let's start with the outline of the unit. Here is my try. I make this outline. It takes me 2 pages, as you can see. And you can do something similar in your notebook at the same time that I'm going to explain it. So, as you can see, I have used some items like keys, right? And also these dots that they are called usually bullets. Here I wrote the title, Unit 9, the Plant Kingdom, and I have the heads underlined, like number 1, the Plant Kingdom, number 2, plant organs, number 3, nutrition in plants, number 4, interaction, and number 5, reproduction. So just with taking a look to this outline, you can see all the parts of the unit. This is very useful in science because we always have a lot of names, a lot of types, classification, things like that. And I think it helps a lot to remember all of these parts and group them and put them in order. So I always try to, when I have to study, I always try to make an outline of the unit. So with just taking a look, I can pick the most important things that I have to remember. Also, it's important when you are making an outline to put just the keywords, I mean, the most important words in every part. So you don't need to write all the definitions. You don't need to put all the examples. Just the most important words that usually in your book, you can see it in bold letters, the thick black letters. So I think this is the fastest and easiest way to do it. Take a look to the most important words and write them. If you need some to add some notes or examples, something to clarify the meaning or to help you to remember what these words mean, you can add also your notes on the sides. So let's start with the first part, the Plant Kingdom. This is like a thumb up of the my outline. The Plant Kingdom has some characteristics that you already know. And I always refer to the chart in previous lessons that explain all the characteristics of every kingdom. So the main characteristics are that plants are multicellular. They have eukaryotic plant cells. You know what this mean. They have autotrophic nutrition, especially photosynthesis. They cannot move freely because they usually live fixed to the soil. Right? So these are the main characteristics. The next step or the next part is the classification of plants. We have two main categories, non-flowering plants and flowering plants. Sorry for the handwriting because maybe it's not so clear, but you should do your own outline. So you always can take a look to the book and follow the lesson with your book. So inside the non-flowering plants, we find mosses and liverworts. This is the first category inside the non-flowering plants, and they are non-vascular plants. They don't have these conducting tissues. The other group are ferns, and ferns, they are vascular plants. Inside the flowering plants, that they are also known as spermatophytes, we have gymnosperms without fruits and angiosperms with fruits. These are the main differences. Also, you can add, if you want, some examples of these groups of plants to help you to remember all the characteristics. Okay, this is just the most important things, but inside every point, every bullet, you need to know what angiosperms means. Then we have the importance of plants in the biosphere. There are a lot of them. I just put the main words of every point. So they are producers of oxygen. They absorb CO2, carbon dioxide, to make organic matter. Also, they can regulate or participate in the regulation of the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and that reduces the greenhouse effect. The global warming is reduced by plants because they take carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Also, they are the most important part of the food chain, especially in terrestrial ecosystems. Also, plants prevent soil erosion, and plants can regulate or they participate in the water cycle thanks to evapotranspiration. Let's move on. The second point, plant organs. The most complex plants, I mean every plant except the non-vascular plants, the mosses and liverworts, they don't have really organs, real organs. But the rest of the plants, ferns, angiosperms, and gymnosperms, all of them have organs. These organs are roots, stems, and leaves. As you can see, these points follow the same order, or it has the same parts. First of all, roots. You can write the parts of the organ and also the function. In stems, you can see parts of the stems and function. And inside leaves, you can see the parts and function. So the same outline for every point is followed by the book. So which are the parts of the roots? Well, we have primary roots, secondary roots, root hairs, and root cap. In your book, you have a good picture of a root with all of these parts. It's important to know where are they and also what are their functions. In general, the functions of the root are to absorb water and minerals from the soil, thanks to the root hairs. Also, roots can store food reserves, and you have some examples of that, like beets and carrots. And the other function is that the roots anchor the plant to the ground, so the plant can stand in the soil and it doesn't move. Right, then we have the stems, the second organ. Stems have some parts that they are called nodes. You have to know what is a node. Also auxiliary buds, apical buds, and internodes. As always, you can see all of these parts in your book because they are written in the picture. Then we have the function of the stems. They keep the plant vertical, they support the plant, and they transport substances. Also, they store food reserves. So here we have 1, 2, and 3 functions. Okay, so you can use a key like this and put one on top of each other. Then we have leaves. You can see also the parts of the leaf in page number 141. The most important parts of the leaf are leaf seeds. You have petiole, blade, the top side, the underside, veins, and also the apex. You can write also the blade and put these brackets, because top side, underside, vein, and apex belongs to the blade. The blade is the white flat part of the leaf, and all of these parts are included inside the blade. And the functions of the leaves, you don't have these in your book so explicit. So the main functions are to carry out the photosynthesis and to carry out the gas exchange. We will see this in the nutrition part, but because we know it already, we can add it to complete our outline. Right? Let's move on to the next point. The third point is nutrition in plants. As you already know, plants are autotrophs. They produce organic matter from inorganic substances. And this process, it is carried out in 5 steps that you can see here. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The first step is the absorption. Absorption is carried out by the roots, and it consists in taking water and mineral salts from the soil, right? The mixture of water and mineral salts inside the plant is called RoSap. So you need to remember these important words. You can also, I don't know if I can do it here with this marker. Yes, very good, I like it. So you can also use colors to highlight some words that maybe they are difficult for you, they are new for you. So you can highlight them to see it very, very easily. Transport is carried out by the stem. Inside the stem, you can find conducting tissues. These tissues are like tubes that go through the stem, and we can classify them in two groups, the xylem and the phloem. The xylem transport rows up from roots to leaves, and phloem transport elaborated sap from leaves to all the parts of the plant, right? The transformation of raw sap into elaborated sap is produced during the photosynthesis, and the photosynthesis take place in the leaves. So this elaborated sap produced in the leaf has to go to every cell, every part of the plant, and this transport is carried out by the phloem system. The next step is photosynthesis. Photosynthesis take place inside the chloroplast. You know that they are organelles in the eukaryotic plant cells, and they are very abundant in the leaves of the plant. The process consists in transforming water, carbon dioxide, using the energy of the sunlight to produce organic matter and oxygen. So with this formula, you can remember what is photosynthesis. The process of photosynthesis consists on transforming water and carbon dioxide using the sunlight to produce organic matter and oxygen. This process in the chloroplasts is carried out thanks to chlorophyll. Chlorophyll, as you know, is a pigment that reacts with the sunlight and can use this energy to transform the raw sap, water and CO2 into organic matter and oxygen. And photosynthesis only takes place during the day because it needs sunlight. So during the night, plants cannot carry out the photosynthesis. The next step is the cellular respiration. It takes place in the mitochondrion. Mitochondrion is an organelle that you can find it in all eukaryotic cells, in plants and even in animals. So inside the mitochondrion, the organic matter with oxygen is transformed into energy, carbon dioxide, and water vapor. So I repeat, the organic matter with oxygen is burned, no, is transformed into to produce energy, carbon dioxide, and water vapor. So you can highlight also this formula because it's very useful to understand what's going on inside the mitochondrion, what is the cellular respiration. And the cellular respiration takes place or is carried out during the whole day, during the day and during the night. The last process is the gas exchange. All of these gases, the CO2, the oxygen, the water vapor, all of these gases needs to go from the atmosphere to the leaves and from the leaves to the atmosphere. So this is the gas exchange. This exchange is produced by the stomata. The stomata are those pores, those little holes in the leaves that allows these gases to go in and out from the leaves to the atmosphere. So in the case of the photosynthesis, the plant takes from the atmosphere CO2 and expel oxygen or release oxygen. During the cellular respiration, the plant takes oxygen from the atmosphere and expel CO2 and water vapor. So these are the gases that they are moving in and out from the atmosphere and the plant. Then we have the next part of the unit is the interaction. Interaction, I wrote the definition. You can do it also if you want, because sometimes students forget the definition of interaction. Interaction can be defined as the ability to detect stimuli and react to them by making responses. We have two types of interaction, of movement, two types of responses. They are called tropisms and nastic movements. Tropisms are the responses of the plant to stimuli that they are permanent. So once this movement is produced, it takes it stays forever, right? We have four examples in your book. Phototropism, that the stimuli is light. Geotropism, the stimulus is gravity. Hydrotropism, the stimulus is water. And thigmotropism, that the stimulus is the contact with solid objects. And the nastic movements, these movements are temporary. So when the stimuli stops, stops, and this movement disappear or stops also. The example are photonasty, that the stimuli is light, chemionasty is chemical substances, thermonasty, the stimuli is temperature, and seismonasty is the contact with solid objects. Also, you can add, if you want, an example of plant in all of these types of movements. You have some examples in your book, pages number 144 and 145. And the last point is the reproduction. The reproduction, we know what does it mean. We have two types, asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. It's important to know the difference between them. I didn't write the difference or the characteristics of every type of sexual reproduction, but you can write these characteristics if you need it. So asexual reproduction, we have in our book four examples: stolons, tubers, bulbs, and rhizomes. I wrote this difference because I think it's important. Stolons are aerial stems, right? They are on the surface. But tubers, bulbs, and rhizomes, they are underground stems. So this is the basic difference between these types of asexual reproduction. They are modified stems, that they are underground, But stolons are modified stems that they are aerial over the surface. And the other type is sexual reproduction. Sexual reproduction, we have examples in non-flowering plants and in flowering plants. Remember that most of these plants have also a sexual reproduction, right? Well, non-flowering plants, we can distinguish between mosses and ferns. Mosses and liverworts use spores that they are inside capsules, and in the case of ferns, they use spores in sori. Sori that you can remember, sori are those tiny balls in the located at the underside of the leaves that they are called fronds. So they use also spores, but they are inside sori, these special structures. In flowering plants, we can find a lot of concepts, a lot of ideas. First of all, the parts of the flower. We have to know what is a flower. It's a structure that that protect and to have, it has the sexual organs of the plant. Inside the plant, we can distinguish the outer part. These are the outer part, corolla and calyx. Corolla is made by petals. Remember the leaves with bright colors in the flower. The calyx are the sepals with a green color. And they protect the outer envelope, protect the reproductive organs. Also, in the flower, we can find the peduncle, which is the part of the stem that connects with the flower. The reproductive organs are stamen, which is the male reproductive organ that produce the male gametes. It has two parts. The anther is where it contains the pollen grains, and the filament that join the anther with the flower. And also we have the pistil, which is the female reproductive organ that has four parts. The stigma is the part on the top of the pistil. You can make a tiny drawing also. Whoops. So the pistil has like a bottle shape. Oh, come on. Oh, I don't know what's going on. Right, so the pistil has this bottle shape. The upper part is the stigma. The neck of the bottle is the style. The bottom part is the ovary, and inside the bottom part you have the ovules, which are the female gametes. Also, the next part is of the process of sexual reproduction is the pollination. Pollination, you know, is the transport of the pollen grain from the anther to the pistil. And this transport is produced or carried out by the wind or animals. Remember some insects like bees that they take pollen from a flower to the other. So this process is called pollination. The next step is fertilization. Fertilization consists in the union of the male and female gametes. When these cells join together and fusion, a new plant is starts, right? So this is the fertilization. Usually follow some steps. First of all, the pollen grain reach the stigma, then a pollen tube is formed, and through the pollen tube, two sexual cells go through the pollen tube to reach the ovules, and then the fertilization, it takes place. When the ovule is fertilized, it transforms into a seed. A seed has three parts: the embryo, which is the baby plant inside the seed, the endosperm, that is a reservoir of food for the development and germination of the seed, and also a protective layer, which is called the seed coat. After the fertilization, the ovary with the ovules inside, it transforms into a fruit. Okay, for this is just for the angiosperm plants. Remember that gymnosperm plants doesn't have fruits. So angiosperm plants produce fruits that gives a fruit gives protection and helps with the dispersion of the seeds. These are the main functions. And the last step is the germination. When the seed reach the soil and the conditions are good, humidity, temperature, and so on, then the new plant starts to grow. At the beginning, the plant, the seed is underground, the new plant doesn't have leaves, roots, so at the first steps, it needs to take energy from the endosperm. But after that, the first roots appear, that they are called radicle, and some tiny leaves appear, right? I'm going to draw it. This is the soil, this is the seed. So first, these tiny roots, early roots, that they are called radicle, appear, and a little stem also appear, and some tiny leaves also are formed. These tiny leaves are called cotyledons. These cotyledons can carry out the photosynthesis to give energy to the rest of the plant to keep on growing, right? If you find just one cotyledon, the plant is called monocotyledon, and if you have two tiny leaves, the plant is called decotyledon, right? When the plant becomes bigger, true leaves are formed, right? And the cotyledons disappear. Okay, this is the like the final process, and this is a real new plant. Okay, so this is the end of the unit. I hope this outline is useful for you. Remember that you can do it on your own way. You can take notes, draw little pictures to help you to understand or to remember the meaning of all of these words. And keep on studying this unit, because at the end of the next week, I will prepare a test. If you have any doubts, you can You can ask me as always, and I will give you also some exercises to practice and remember all of these ideas of this unit. So hope you like it and enjoy it. See you in the next lesson. Bye.